Mary buy goods on credit from Kim. Now there are two parties in this question. One is Mary and one is Kim. Now in such a question, first of all, you need to identify that who are you and who is the other party. You need to identify yourself and the opposite party. Now how can we do that? Mary receives, we'll be seeing in the later part, Mary received 14% credit discount on all purchases and takes advantage of 5% cash discount offered for payment within 14 days. Means there are two types of discount. One is credit discount and one is cash discount. Credit discount is given or received when we are buying or selling something in bulk that is more than one unit. And cash discount is basically given or received, allowed or received whenever our customers are paying us earlier than promised or we are paying our suppliers promptly. Okay, the following information is given. Now let us move to the first requirement, and in the first requirement the examiner says name the document in book of prime entry used by Kim. You should underline that part, used by Kim. Used by Kim means we are Kim. Okay, used by Kim, and this can further be confirmed, verified by looking at the C part. In the C part, the examiner says, write up the ledger account. Ledger account means a D account of Mary in Kim's books. Okay, we need to make an account of Mary in Kim's books. Beta, if the books are of Kim's, means you are Kim. Okay, whoever owned the books or whoever owned the ledgers, this means that is the main party. And in this question, we are Kim and we need to make an account of Mary. Now the question arises whether Mary is our customer or Mary is our supplier. Mary is buying goods from Kim. Now who would be buying from a supplier? Whether a customer would be buying from us or whether our supplier will be buying from us? No, our customers will be buying from us. Therefore, we are Kim in this question and Mary is our customer. So first of all, if you have identified this, that who are you and who is the other party, okay, so we can now move further. Now in the first of the requirement, what we need to do, we need to identify the source documents that we discussed earlier, such as invoice, receipt and check counterfoil and all of that, and book of prime entry we need to identify for 4th and 8th June production. So you need to keep an eye on the question whenever you want to refer to it. On the 4th June, as you can see, the transaction is Kim sold goods to Mary list price 800. Whenever we are selling goods to someone on credit, the document that we'll be issuing is sales invoice. Okay, the seller always issues sales invoice, and the book in which that sales invoice would be entered is sales journal, also known as sales day book. Okay, sales journal or sales day book. So this was basically the first transaction. Then on the 8th of June, Mary has returned goods purchased on 4th June. If customer is returning goods back to us, this is basically a return inward transaction, also known as yes sale return. So the document would be credit note. Okay, so actually when Mary returned goods to us, Mary issued us a debit note. Whenever the customer returns us the goods, faulty goods, the book is return inwards journal, also known as sales return journal or sales return day book. Now in the B part, the question asks for state the name of the document Mary received on 30th June. Now at the end of the month, we being suppliers send our customers a statement which is known as statement of account. Statement of account is basically a reminder and a summary of all the transactions that have took place with the customer and during the month, and we are now giving them some reminder so as they should remind us to pay us the amount that they owe to us. Okay, now on the C part, we need to make the ledger account of Mary in Kim's books. Now as you may be aware, in this question we are Kim. And if we are Kim, we need to make Mary's account. Mary is basically our customer. So what we need to do, we need to make customer's account. Now on 1st June, if you can see, Mary owes Kim 680. If Mary is owing us 680, this is basically an asset for us. And this is basically a trade receivable that is 680. Okay, Mary is the customer. And the customer is basically an asset for the business. Now we
are expecting 680 from ARI. And next transaction on 4th June. On 4th June, Kim sold goods to Mary, list price 800. Now, my dear students, whenever we sell goods to our customer on credit, the entry is customer account would be debited and the sales account would be credited. So, Mary account would be debited and sales account would be credited. Now, we are selling goods for 800, but the 800 is list price. We never buy or sell on list price. Instead, we deduct a discount known as trade discount. Now, we need to apply a 14% discount on 800. If we apply it, the answer is 112. If we deduct 112 from 800, the amount that we are left with is 688. Okay, 688 is basically the sales amount, and we won't be recording the 112 discount because trade discount is never recorded in the books, neither it is recorded in customer's account and nor it is recorded in supplier's account. Okay, so for us sales is 688 and for Mary the sales would be purchase would be 688. Okay, then the next transaction that we have after 4th June, on 5th June Mary has sent Kim a check for the balance owing on 1st June. Now, if you can see on 1st June, we were asking for 680 from Mary, and Mary owed us 680, and now she has paid it on 5th June. And now we need to see whether the Mary is eligible for a cash discount or not. Now, the question states that if the customer pay us within 14 days, the discount that is being applicable is trade discount. Okay. If the customer is paying us within 14 days, the discount would be cash discount. So we won't be comparing 1st June with 5th June. Instead, we'll be comparing 29th May. If you can read the 1st June entry, it says that Mary owed Kim 680 for goods purchased on 29th May. Now we need to compare the 29th May with 5th June, and this becomes around 6 to 7 days. So if Mary is paying within 14 days, she is eligible for a cash discount of 14%. 5%. Cash discount is 5%. Now if we apply 5% on 680 balance, the discount would be 34. Okay, so this is basically discount allowed. There are two types of discounts. One is discount allowed and one is the sale. Whenever our customer is paying us earlier than promised, this is discount allowed. And whenever we are paying a supplier earlier than promised, then this is discount received. So out of the 680, we have received the 34 amount, and the difference would be bank. So the entry would be bank account would be debited and Mary account would be credited. Okay. Let me explain you this with the help of a journal entry. What are we doing? We are debiting discount allowed. Why are we debiting discount allowed? Because discount allowed is basically an expense for the business, and expense is always debited. Discount allowed would be debited, and bank account would be debited as well. Why is bank being debited? Because the bank amount is increasing. Whenever an asset is increased, it is always debited. And Mary account will be credited by full amount, that is 680. Mary would be credited by 680. The entry would be discount allowed debit, bank debit, and Mary account would be credited. It is on 4th June, list price 100 to Kim. Whenever Mary is returning goods to us, this is basically a return inward transaction. Entry would be return inward would be debited, and Mary account would be credited. Okay, return inward would be debited and Mary account would be credited. Now you must remember, whenever we sell goods to Mary, we allow her a trade discount of 14%. Now whenever we receive the goods in return back from Mary, we would also deduct the trade discount, and we would never return the goods in full price. Why? Because if we are selling to her after 14% discount, why would we returning it for the whole amount? Okay, so the entry would be return inward would be debited and Mary credit. Then out of $100 list price, will be deducting $14. So we are left with the $86 return inward. Let us move further. We have next transaction that Kim sold further goods to Mary, 300. We are selling goods to Mary. Whenever we sell goods to a customer, the entry would be customer debit and sales credit. So we are selling goods for 300, but this is the list price. What we need to do, we need to deduct trade discount from it as well. Whenever we are selling or buying, we'll be using trade discount, and whenever we are paying someone or someone is paying to us, we'll be
deducting cash discount. Okay, so if I apply 14% to 300, this would be 42, and if I deduct 42 from 300, amount would be 258. You must remember, trade discount is never recorded in the books. Now, next transaction is that Kim received a check from Mary for goods purchased on 4th June. The goods that we have sold for 4th June for 688, now Mary is giving us the payment on 29th June. Now, if we compare 4th June with 25th June, there is a difference of around 25 days in between. If the customer is paying after 25 days, will she be eligible for a cash discount? No, in this question. Why? Because we are will be giving cash discount if the customer agrees to pay within 14 days. And if the customer is paying after 14 days, she is not eligible for a cash discount. So we would be expecting to receive the total amount, but there is a problem in this, and the problem is that on 4th June we have sold the goods, although the list price was 800, but we have sold it for 688. So we won't be expecting that the customer will pay us 800, the full amount. We will be expecting the customer will pay us 688 on 4th June of sale. But there is another problem in that, and another issue is that after 4th June, on 8th June, we have return inward also for $86. If the customer has returned goods from 688, if she have already returned goods worth 86, we won't be expecting that the customer will pay us for this the goods that we have returned back. Okay, so if I deduct 688 and 86, the balance that I have been left with is 602. You must remember, whenever customer will pay us the amount due, she will always be deducting the goods that she have already returned to us. Now, if I balance this account, as you may be aware that this is basically a debtor account. Debtor is basically an asset for the business. So the bigger side would be debit side. Okay, it is 1626. If we keep the bigger side on both of the side, the shorter side would become balance carried down. And this balance carried down at the end of the year, end of the period, would become balance brought down at the start of next period. After June, there comes July. Okay, so this was basically C part. We need to make a T account for customer. Now the next requirement that we have in this question is that relating to ledger. Now, what does the ledger mean, my dear students? Ledger is basically a book which contains T accounts. There are only three ledgers in accounting. One is sales ledger, one is purchase ledger, and another one is general ledger. Now, what is basically a sales ledger? Sales ledger is basically a book which contains T accounts of customers only, that is debtors. A purchase ledger is a book which contains T accounts of creditors, that is suppliers. And a book that contains T accounts of all other T accounts other than debtor and creditor would be a general ledger. General ledger is also known as nominal ledger. Okay, so in the question we are being given with some of the accounts, and we need to identify that for each of the account what type of ledger would be suited. Okay, for sales account we'll be using general ledger, and for drawings is another thing, we also be using general ledger. Okay, for sales we'll be using general ledger, for drawings also we'll be using general ledger. Then after that we have supplier, that is client limited. If we have a supplier, it is written in the question clearly that it is a supplier. We do not need to guess it whether it is a customer or supplier. Okay, if client limited is a supplier, this would be entered in a purchase ledger. Then we have another one, that is Miller and Son, and in the question it is written that Miller and Son is a customer. So customer always comes in a sales ledger. Then we have insurance. Insurance is basically an expense for the business, and expense always comes in a general ledger. So other than customer and supplier, all of the things would come in a general ledger. Customer would come in a sales ledger, supplier would come in a purchase ledger, and all other things would come in a general ledger. Just wait a while. Okay, let us move to the last part of the question. And in the last part of the question, we have been asked for advantages of computerized accounting. Now, as you may be aware, whenever we need to make accounts, there are two methods to do that. One is manual accounts, making manual accounts with a pen and paper, that the traditional method of accounting, and one is computerized accounting. Computerized accounting, we'll be using computers and softwares for accounting and finance, and therefore we'll be using computerized accounting. Now, what is the advantage of using computerized accounting? First of all, there is an advantage that large volume of data can be processed or stored. Large volume of data can be stored in a, as you can see, in a simple flash drive, that is a USB data traveler. In a, such a small space, you can store tons of GBs. Then we have a greater speed of data processing. If we are processing data, it can be processed in a much faster way as compared to the manual way of accounting. Then errors can be minimized, or they can be easily identified. We cannot say that after the advent of computerized accounting, all of the errors would be disappear altogether. We cannot eliminate the errors and fraud. We can just minimize or manage it. Okay, we can just minimize that. We cannot completely eliminate that. Then there is accuracy of data process. The data that is processed using computerized accounting is far more accurate as compared to the data that we are processing through using manual way of accounting. Okay.